Tri Waco, the Greater Waco Chamber of Commerce's annual Olympic and Sprint Distance Triathlon, will begin at 6:30 a.m. on Sunday, July 9th at Indian Spring Park. Over 900 participants are expected for this event. The race starts with a point-to-point open water swim in the Brazos River, followed by a flat and fast bike ride on the spectator-friendly roads near the river, and finishes with a run along the Brazos River through Cameron Park, finishing on the famous suspension bridge. Tri Waco will again include relay options as well as the aqua bike races. Online registration is open through Friday, July 7, 2023 at triwaco.org. The Tri Waco Triathlon is presented by Bicycle World. Again, online registration is open through Friday, July 7, 2023 at triwaco.org. This is a Rogue Media Network podcast.
Home Abstract and Title Company was founded in 1867 and is the oldest company still operating in McLennan County. Home Abstract is comprised of a team of honest, friendly, hardworking professionals dedicated to providing both commercial and residential real estate clients with the highest level of communication and service. Their team is committed to working hard and building and maintaining strong relationships because transactions are so much more than just deals. They are clients, deserving of the courtesy, care, and respect that Home Abstract and Title Company is known for. Visit Home Abstract and Title Company at homeabstract.com. Cross the Brazos and Waco, ride hard and I'll make it by dawn. Cross the Brazos and Waco, I'm safe when I reach San Antonio. Welcome back to the Waco History Podcast. We are going through our Crossroads series, right, Rick? How many episodes in are we?
We are going through it, let me tell you.
I think we're getting
It takes two hands right now to count how many we've done.
We've done this many. Yes. That works great for podcast world. But we are diving into two episodes that we're going to do on arts and entertainment in Waco. Waco is a arts and entertainment crossroads. And we have a special guest for our first one. We're going to focus on places and venues.
Places and spaces. It's got to rhyme. Make it rhyme a little bit.
That's nice.
Okay.
Places and spaces for arts and entertainment in Waco. And who is our guest, Rick?
Fiona Bond.
Hi, guys. Thanks for inviting me.
Yes. Well, for our listeners, the first thing you'll notice, if you don't know Fiona, is she doesn't sound like she's from around here.
She ain't from around here.
And you're expecting me to talk about history, so, you know.
Yeah, so give our listeners some background on you, kind of where your accent comes from, and how you ended up in Waco.
I say I'm from very far east Texas, so obviously I'm originally from the UK, and been in Waco now for about just over 10 years. And it is my privilege to be CEO of Creative Waco, which means I get to do the cultural development piece of life and work in our city, in our community. So I'm really intrigued with what I might learn by this conversation with you guys. And I've discovered all kinds of interesting things about the places and spaces that have been part of Waco's story, especially as a cultural crossroads.
Wow. And she's using good name placement already. I mean, that's a good sign.
That's right. Yeah. Brought to you by Brotherwell Brewing. Nothing goes better with spaces and places and entertainment than a beer from Brotherwell Brewing.
I'm going to say specifically the Waco town because it supports Creative Waco.
Oh, see, there you go. There is a tie-in.
Nice tie-in.
There is
totally.
A tie-in.
Okay, well, let's start. Let's start talking about early Waco, right? So 1850s, the culture of Waco is starting. It's actually, people are just trying to live. They're just trying to eke out a living. So
yeah, entertainment is not a top priority in 1850s Waco.
At least not high art entertainment. I mean, I'm guessing there was plenty of singing, plenty of saloons and shooting and all kinds of bars and victuals.
Well, and you know, I know you're taking a negative approach here, but there was a lot of church
going.
Who's
saying that's negative?
Yeah, that's just a good weekend.
Okay, well, then I really do need to talk about it. There was church going and revivals, reunions. You know, there was people were getting together and they were being entertained. And you did bring up singing. It's interesting to watch period movies and how much people just broke out in song when they were together, right? I mean, that was so much more a part of life.
Some of those are musicals, Rick. I mean, maybe you're talking about Oklahoma. I mean, that's not a documentary.
You clearly hang out with, you know, more interesting people than me.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, no, it's it was more of kind of a Pitch Perfect thing. But the people would sit around and entertain themselves and each other by playing instruments and singing.
Yeah.
You know,
well,
I mean, it wasn't.
And I love that that already picks up a strand that I've noticed in some of the historic things that I've looked at with the arts in Waco, that a lot of the things that we now have our sights set on are things that have their deep roots here too. So yeah. Church music, for example, is something that has always been something that Waco has had standout skill and expertise, and, you know, something that we've punched above our weight as a small community in the fact that we now have at Baylor and at MCC really standout music programs, and that the church music program and the Black gospel music program are internationally known. They have their roots right there in those early churches.
Right. And when we in further episodes where we do start talking about actual personalities, I mean, New Hope Baptist Church had a lot of talent that came from the roots of that institution.
Yeah, definitely.
So, in fact, one character I will recognize here, you see in the writings a lot, early Waco, and pictures and photos and stuff, was a fiddle player named Uncle Dan McLennan. So this guy, he was born as a slave to the Neil McLennan family, and then after the Civil War, was a freedman, but stayed close to the family. He, you know, I think he farmed with them, and I think he didn't end up passing away till into the 1900s, but he was known as a great fiddle player, and he would get hired to do all these reunions and get togethers that we were talking about. And eventually his sons would play with him as well. So there was talent there, you know. It was just different in how it was expressed as opposed to how we would do it now. He wasn't uploading songs to Spotify.
Well, and I'm guessing at that time there weren't places that were built dedicated for the performing arts. I mean, we're looking at very kind of things that are popping up as part of people gathering in other kinds of spaces.
Right, right. There's that movie that Tom Hanks recently did that was, I think, called News to the World. It's a great depiction. Shows him traveling actually through Texas, through our part of Texas, and basically he was a news reader. He would take the news of the day and go from community to community and share it. And so those activities were going on, but oration was a much bigger part of people's lives. You know, you read about certain individuals and them being great orators, kind of a lost art. I mean, we have people who are good public speakers now, but, you know, they talk about crowds of thousands coming to listen to someone speak, and there was no magnification or whatever audio equipment to amplify their voices. I mean, they were projecting out in the open to these thousands of people. I think that's really cool.
I'm guessing that's a mixed blessing if you have bad news to share. maybe that would change the kind of news that we would be faced with if it had to be presented in that way now.
Yes. Well, since he was getting paid for it, I bet he brought a lot of good news, would be my guess.
Yeah, and you, before we started recording, Fiona, you talked about powwows, you know, that would have predated settlement and all these spaces that would have been spaces of entertainment, cultural transmission, all those sorts of things.
I've come to know some of the folks that are in the Wichitan affiliated tribes and their leadership, and they talk about how, you know, Waco, because of its location and because it was a strategic crossing of the river, was a place that different tribes, different family groups would come to. And so, you know, probably as long as there have been humans in this area, it's been a gathering place. Mm-hmm. It's one of the things that I really love, because I think that's very much Waco's personality now, is as a gathering place. And I'm really curious what that looked like over different time and with different cultural groups, because it really has been a cultural crossroads. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one of the things that is most fascinating, and that also gives us this really lovely, rich, diverse cultural infrastructure now.
Mm-hmm. You know, the before we jump out of the 1800s or move more towards the
wow, that's a whiplash. We can't jump out of the 1800s.
Well, I know, but I was going to say, I think when we talk about in the 1870s, the Chisholm Trail kicks up, the bridge is here, it becomes a major crossing for the cattle drives.
Then we get Camp MacArthur, and suddenly there are more people to entertain.
Yeah, there are.
And less of the bawdy stuff, because that actually meant the closing down, I think, of some of the risque entertainment.
There is kind of a good comparison between cattle drive, you know, cowboys and soldiers. They do, at a base level, look for some of the same entertainment. I mean, there were a lot of saloons and billiard halls in Waco. You can find that in their advertisements in the handbooks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there were bathhouses and natatoriums and, you know, places where you go, you know, get cleaned up if you've been on the trail for days at a time. So I think there was a lot of that and the reservation, which has been talked about on this podcast a few times. You know, there was.
That's right. Yeah. Illicit entertainment, but it was legal, so it wasn't illicit.
It was legal, yeah. One of the two cities in America to make it legal.
Yeah. I think of the big kind of event that makes Waco a crossroads as far as a destination for people coming in from out of town for entertainment and the arts. I guess I think of the Cotton Palace, the Texas Cotton Palace. Which starts in 1894. I mean, that seems like a landmark.
Yeah.
If we're going to talk about a place and a space, that seems really important here.
And here we're talking about an era of huge exhibitions being such a big pull.
Yeah.
I mean, these become destinations, right? I'm thinking of the Crystal Palace in London.
The World's Fair.
Mm-hmm. Yes. All of those kinds of things where people will travel. They'll make it their family vacation to travel to one of these places. How visionary to have something like that in Waco.
Yeah, so first Cotton Palace, it's not a happy story. Governor Hogg comes, it's dedicated in the fall of 1894. It burns to the ground in January 1895. So the first Cotton Palace is a success, but also a quick tragedy for the city. And of course, we'll talk about when we get to the 20th century, the revival of the Cotton Palace, which is really important.
Mm-hmm.
So before we get to the second Cotton Palace, I want to talk about, Fiona's brought us some wonderful artifacts from the Waco Auditorium. Maybe tell folks about the Waco Auditorium, Fiona.
Yes. Well, so this is courtesy of my friend Laurie Davidson, who actually runs the Waco Trolley. So quick shout out and thank you to Laurie. She gave me this souvenir program for the dedication of the new auditorium in Waco, Texas, knowing that Creative Waco is working on potentially a new performing arts center. So this was December 1st, 1899. And this was a brand new, huge performing arts center, which really was one of the largest performing arts centers west of the Mississippi at that time. And
3,000 seats.
Yes, this was, I mean, it was an incredibly bold and visionary thing to build in Waco. At the time, it did not have a population that would have made that an obvious thing to do. But of course, with Camp MacArthur there and...
not yet. Camp MacArthur didn't come till...
Oh, yes, sorry. That was slightly later. But I think at that point, there was already rapidly growing population.
Yeah.
I think we had 7 railroad connections at that point. There were great hopes still. This is before the lock and dam failure out on the Brazos. Right, there was great hopes that... You know, you had the navigators playing. We had great hopes that the Brazos would be navigable. Yeah, so in when it's finished in 1899, the hopes for the city, and it's Waco's only 20,000 at that point.
Yeah.
The hopes for the city are by 1910, Waco would be 60,000 people.
Wow.
It's going to miss that mark. It does become 60,000 people, but after World War II. So they missed the mark a little bit, and so I think within a couple of years, the auditorium, even though it's a grand venue, they have to cut the capacity in half just because of the attendance that occur.
Right. Nobody likes sitting in a show that's not sold out, right? I mean, it's just not, the energy's not there.
Well, Fiona can probably tell us the
sustainability level of an auditorium in Waco right now, well, which is around 2,000.
And I don't mean to geek out too much, but you put 3,000 people in any one room together, pre-air conditioning, it's going to get pretty hot and sultry pretty fast.
It all comes back to air conditioning.
It does. And as
the history of the South driven by air conditioning.
And for our listeners who don't know, there is a whole episode on the how Waco got cool, but we won't go into that right now. But I will say, in modern terms, I mean, a 3,000-seat auditorium needs a couple hundred tons of air conditioning just to make it feasible to sit in there. So you can imagine they had a lot of ventilation that they would use, but there's only certain times of the year you could put that many people in there and it'd be comfortable.
Dark red velvet covered seats.
Sounds warm.
Yeah, you do not want to sweat into those. So there's this fantastic story. By 1915, the person who was running the auditorium was a character who I really wish I could have met, named Gussie Oscar. Gussie was a woman. And she was arrested twice for the absolutely shocking crime of conducting a business and having performances on a Sunday.
Oh, my gosh.
And she clearly was, she sounds like a real opportunist and apparently ran an extremely tight ship and strict business. But she sounds like she was a fairly interesting character.
Yes.
Capitalist. She would tour New York and bring back kind of talent to come to Waco. And she got in, as you say, hot water for performances on Sunday, but also some of the acts that she brought back that some of the, you know, chorus girls.
Lowered the tone a little.
Yeah, flappers, you know, some of the things she brought back that maybe New York was ready for, but Waco was challenged to support.
Well, and we've talked about before in the economics crossroads what a big shot in the arm Camp MacArthur was when World War I came. So you bring 30, 40,000 young soldiers to your town, they're looking for entertainment. And I mean, I think that was really the apex of Waco Auditorium from all indications.
And it closes, as Fiona reminded me earlier, in 1928. And it's raised in 1929. They convert it to show silent movies at one point. Birth of a Nation is shown in the Waco Auditorium. A lot of personalities. We'll save that for our personalities and entertainment episode. But a lot of personalities are going to appear at the Waco Auditorium.
Yes, all kinds of famous people went through there, which is, you know, it's really interesting to see that when Waco did invest in something that was that much of a destination as an auditorium, it really became a focal point, not just for Waco, but for the whole region, even at a time when it was much harder to travel from somewhere like Dallas or Fort Worth or Austin to Waco. And it was right there on North 6th Street and Columbus Avenue. So it was right in the heart of downtown on that hill. So it would have been visible, I'm guessing, for
a location marker there. So that'd be right across the street from St. Paul's Episcopal Church and catty corner from the jail that sits behind the courthouse right there. That intersection,
That's maybe a strong metaphor as well as a strong location.
Yeah, a lot going on in that corner.
Right between the church and the jail.
So
the arts often inhabits that space.
So over 2,400 performances over the life of this 28-year life of the Waco Auditorium. So definitely a central place in the entertainment and arts scene in Waco for a long time.
Which ironically, that's a pretty short lifespan for a building, 30 years of this nature. And looking at, you know, the pictures of it, the visuals, it was very pleasing, eye-pleasing building architecturally. And it's a shame that it didn't survive.
It actually looks like it might have been designed to complement the Cotton Palace building. I mean, there are some similarities between the shape of the two.
I think you're right, yeah. And listener, as you say, I want to see it, go over to the Waco History app and you can see pictures of the Waco Auditorium.
And we can maybe post pictures of this program.
We can.
That Laurie passed me. And actually, I realized I made a mistake earlier. I was saying Friday, December the 1st, 1899. Actually, it was Thanksgiving, Thursday, November the 30th, and Friday, December the 1st. So it was, you know, it was over the Thanksgiving break that they launched this.
Governor Hogg came back. William Jennings Bryan was there. Mm-hmm. Frequent failed presidential candidate, but...
that was foreshadowing.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I'm seeing Houdini, Will Rogers, Marx Brothers, mm-hmm. so many people that are now household names mm-hmm. came through.
And it's, of course, contemporary with the second Cotton Palace, the Cotton Palace that reopens in 1910.
Yeah, and so similar to what we were just talking about with the auditorium, there was a big push in the business community of Waco. Again, I think they saw the economic development potential here, not just the cultural opportunity, but and so there was a push to raise funds to revive the Cotton Palace, and they ended up building. They were able to raise enough money, so in 1910 they could open the new Cotton Palace with a new Coliseum that could hold as many as 10,000 people in wow. the exhibit building. It also, as it built out, they had racetracks, they had a racetrack, barns, carnival grounds, eventually a Ferris wheel and a roller coaster. And then several years later, they added an 18,000-seat athletic field.
Wow.
Yeah, which we've talked about before in the episode about the death at the Baylor A&M game that was played there in the 20s at the Cotton Palace.
So who would have been going to the Cotton Palace, and how often would it have been open? Would it have been a little bit like our Extra Co Center now,
exactly.
where it would have been fairs, showgrounds, that kind of thing?
Its main focus was tied around the harvest time in the fall. The Cotton Palace would be open, but it's drawing in spectators from far and wide. The record attendance, the Cotton Palace, which still blows my mind. I mean, just so you'll know, this is in an era where Waco's population is about 40,000 in 1920. In 1918, Texas Cotton Palace draws 547,000 people to mm-hmm. attend, which is unbelievable. I mean, let's put that
in context. That is more people than come to a full seasons of Baylor football games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was remarkable.
It was a two-week exhibition, to answer that question a minute mm-hmm. ago. So that was within 2 weeks getting, mm-hmm. you know, 500,000 people through Waco. And you look, you see some, I mean, they were advertising all over the state. They would put advertisements on trains as they were going through the state and had special, special runs of those trains coming to Waco for this event. So it was a pretty coordinated effort to get that many people here in such a short amount of time.
Wow. And I imagine it was a major economic driver when it happened as well, that this was something that was really seen as being a win and was reputationally significant for Waco.
Yeah. It also, you know, I kind of listed some of the amenities on the grounds, but they were also... The events themselves, there were pageants, there were balls and dances, there was a parade that went with it. It's a whole series of events that, made it an exhibition or a spectacle or, mm. you know, thing to go do for many reasons. You know, it appealed to different ages for different reasons. And at the event, there were, just like you'd think of the World's Fair exhibitions, you know, there would be shows of horticulture and machinery, livestock, so you could go and wander the grounds and look at all these latest and greatest things that were coming out.
Yeah, and just because you did a good job positioning where we would find the auditorium. So the Cotton Palace is a 12-acre plot bordered by Clay Avenue, Dutton Avenue, South 16th Street. So there is a little park there on Clay that contains kind of the last remnants of the Cotton Palace Park. There's a little bridge that goes across the creek right there. Mm-hmm. and you can see remnants of a little fountain there. And if you kept going up the grand walkway, you would see the exposition building, kind of where Cesar Chavez Middle mm-hmm. School is now. And so that's the area that would have been the Cotton Palace.
Now, obviously, this was built post-emancipation. And mm-hmm. One of my questions is, you know, I'm guessing at this point, Waco is still segregated. And mm-hmm. so, you know, who was, did that, I'm sure that must have made a difference as to who was in there and who was participating in the activities there.
Yeah, you would have had different access for whites and blacks as far as areas that they could have access to, and areas that they could, you know, elements of the events that they could take part in.
And I guess I asked that because mm-hmm. I'm thinking cotton was associated as a crop with slavery. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I don't know how much that played into that image of the Cotton Palace in Waco. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, at that point, a lot of the African Americans, if they were still farming, they were tenant farmers, and they were still participating in agriculture at that level. Just maybe a little bit of an unfair system, some would say. So cotton was still really important to all peoples, all cultures. It just had different outcomes for them.
Mm-hmm. And I'm guessing that's true of, you know, most of the performing arts and entertainment spaces in this town. Just wanting to acknowledge that because, you know, that's a really significant part of how people would have felt they could participate in mm-hmm. arts and entertainment. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And again, I know we're not talking about personalities on this one, but as we move forward, the ironically beautiful thing is that many of the best known personalities to come out of that for Waco were from the African-American culture.
Okay, you guys are stealing from the personalities episode.
Hey, so back,
No, signposting, I think that's the way to say it, laying the breadcrumbs.
We're building up. Okay, so you were just talking about the actual space over there that still exists. I went and walked it before this episode because where we're recording here at Rogue Studios is about a block away.
That is right.
From where the Cotton Palace was. And so similar to what you just talking about, I walked across the bridge, saw this old fountain dedicated in 1910 by the Floral Society, and there's just kind of a remnant of it there. It's kind of sad. I bet it was beautiful in the day. But then Cesar Chavez is a modern school. I mean, it's been built in the last decade or so. But then next to it is the stadium, or is their track and mm-hmm. football field. Mm. But if you look closely at it, you can still see the concrete and steel abutments. That was the original field. That hasn't changed. That track and field is the legacy field.
So the school inherited that footprint.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The bleachers have been torn down. You know, there's some buildings there that look aged enough to still have been maybe from this era.
Wow.
That, you know, they're just shuttered up now. It was beautiful because when I was driving by looking at it, you know, after school was out, but there were still kids out there practicing soccer on that field. And I'm like, man, the history on that field. And, you know, and these kids still out there trying to improve their skills and get better. And I'm like, they probably don't realize how long this field has been.
Did you start shouting that at them?
I did. I said, Waco History Podcast, get on it now. No, I didn't do that. But how about that? An amenity that is still in use mm-hmm. today for its original purpose.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Well, and speaking of which, so the Hippodrome is then built shortly after that, right? 1914. Mm-hmm. The Hippodrome is built and has obviously gone through a variety of iterations and uses and repurposes. But how great that we still have that space, which was built for performing arts and, you know, for movies and is still used for those purposes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And as we've talked about before, in 1928, they had a fire that gutted it and gave them an opportunity to renovate and rebuild it. And that's when they added, guess it? Come on. What did they add?
Are you talking about the Hippodrome?
Yeah, the Hippodrome.
Oh, it's where they added the, I don't know. What's
air conditioning. You get an F. Oh,
I was
going to
say the bar. That's where my mind goes. But
Should be my reflex,
and they had a bar for Fiona.
They probably always had that.
But there, of course, this is an era where there are a host of movie theaters. I mean, you talk about a business that has become centralized over the years. There's a host of spaces where you could see movies, and some that support spaces for African Americans to see movies. And
so the Alpha Theater.
Alpha Theater up on Clifton Street.
And then also what we now have is the Jubilee Theater, which was also a movie theater and then a vaudeville and risque theater.
Yeah, what were you?
I don't know what I was going to say.
That's a fancy UK word.
So proper. You know, we, I think the gym down on Bridge Street, I mean, there were, and of course, later on, we're going to transition to drive-ins. There's the Joy Drive-In out on Old Dallas Highway, and the Circle Drive-In, which, of course, still has life, a commercial life.
Well, and I've got a little bit of information on the Circle Drive-In. I think it's interesting.
If you lay it on me.
Yeah, so it opened June 21st, 1946. First movie, The Bandit of Sherwood Forest.
Oh, bravo.
Yeah, don't know a thing about that one. But
it's a Robin Hood movie.
Right.
I would guess. And then the
no
60s.
No singing in that.
The 60s started to see the decline as the whole for that genre, the drive-in movie, because of competition from air-conditioned theaters. Man, that's kind of a theme. And
you make it one.
But here's the beauty. They could operate day or night, whereas a drive-in theater, you could only run at night. And if the weather was bad, people didn't show up, but you can go in a building and you're fine. Also contributing factors, the VCR.
Yeah.
Of course. Yes. And maybe some safety features of cars that made it harder to snuggle on the front seat.
Yeah, that they started putting those center consoles in.
Bucket seats killed the drive-in. Bench seats
hypothesis.
And seriously, gas prices, right? So you didn't want to sit there and idle your car for 3 hours in the 70s when you were shelling out for gas. As that Circle Drive-In, it switched to more slasher and X-rated flicks as soon as the family stopped coming, and just kept going downhill from there. Eventually closed in the 80s, or closed in 1980, actually.
And has life today as a flea market over there, which is very active on the weekends.
Yes.
Had some great finds there.
Yeah, there are some great finds.
I'm really fascinated by the fact, we know that the Waco Auditorium was torn down in 1929, and it's in 1930 that Waco Hall is built.
Oh, makes you wonder if that was a coincidence.
Well,
I bet they knew they were obsolete. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'm guessing that, by then it was probably much more obvious that it was Baylor that needed to have a performing arts space. And I know it was part of the city's relationship with Baylor. It was part of the sweetener to keep Baylor in Waco. Mm-hmm. So I'm guessing there was maybe a collision of need with opportunity there.
Also, if we're worried about the propriety of acts that are coming to the theater, perhaps let's put it where the Baptists can watch who's going on stage and who's not going on stage.
You go. This is all speculation, but it'd be really interesting to talk to the city leaders at the time to know how much of that really went into the decision making.
Yes, Gussie can't do her thing.
I'm guessing Gussie didn't get hired on over at Waco Hall.
Gussie Oscar, no, she was.
Yeah, so they built that in 1930 with $400,000 in donations from people in the city of Waco.
It's pretty remarkable that almost 100 years later, I mean, it was 2,200 seats at the time, which is, again, a grand. I mean, that's for Baylor. That's a huge hall at that point. It's amazing that it still suits, I mean, that it's still a viable space for large crowds now, almost 100 years later.
Yeah, and it was the people who built it really did future think. They future proofed it in many ways that I think are really were really prescient. But it still makes a very good performing arts center.
Yeah, 2,200. I mean, that's probably bigger than the student body of Baylor at the turn of the century.
At the time, it is. Yeah. In fact, in course, I can't think of Waco Hall and Waco without mentioning the Waco Symphony Orchestra and their long relationship with Waco Hall as their performance space.
Well, and that's a really good point, because spaces tend to create opportunity. And, a lot of the flourishing that we've seen is because of the spaces that were created. And we're now seeing that, you know, taking the story back over to East Waco, the fact that we now have an outdoor amphitheater on Bridge Street, which of course was, you know, right in the vicinity of where Walker's Auditorium was, you know, was once. And we can talk about that in a minute too. But that has created an opportunity for us to start doing live performances around music. It's allowed us to attract grants, that kind of thing, which means that we're just about to launch the Levitt Amp concert series over there on that new amphitheater. But I wonder how many things in our community have ended up happening like the symphony because we built the spaces.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just because the space was there and presented the opportunity. That's a good point.
I know that from the flip side, one of the strongest reasons to think about a new performing arts center is the fact that now we actually are constrained in what we can do because everything's at capacity. And so we actually don't have the spaces to do certain kinds of presentations like Broadway style shows or operas or ballets and that kind of thing, just because of the economic configuration it requires and the amount of space and all of that kind of thing. There's a whole study in that if anyone's interested. But going back to the Walker Auditorium, that itself became this incredible opportunity. And there we have some of the most famous African-American performers performing in our community. I'd love to know more about the Walker Auditorium. I'm seeing 1945 it started.
Yeah, so Herbert Walker was a fixture in the African-American business community. He had a stables, he had a taxi cab company. I think we've talked about this on an episode before about segregation did present the opportunity for Black entrepreneurs to have businesses. And so Herbert Walker was very active in doing that. Mm-hmm. And so Walker Auditorium was one expression of that. I mean, there was a barbecue pit attached to it at one point. He had several businesses that he operated. But I had the pleasure of interviewing Herbert Walker's daughter and doing an oral history with her, and her and her two sons shared a lot of stories of Walker Auditorium. In fact, Charlotte Floyd Love is her name, and I interviewed her and her two sons, and she talked about being a kid. Her father would not let her go to the auditorium, but she would dial in on the phone and listen to the acts. It would keep her out of that space, but she could stay at home and enjoy all the wonderful acts.
Live streaming.
Yeah, exactly.
In its earliest form.
Exactly, yeah.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, and there were some great acts that went through there.
Well, and it was part of the Chitlin circuit. And I know that, you know, when we were building out the case for the grant that is supporting the Levitt Amp concert series, that was one of the things that we said was we would love to honor the past, present, and then future aspirations of East Waco as a hub for, especially for music.
Yeah, so some of the performers included Ike and Tina Turner, James Brown, B.B. King, Etta James.
Wow.
I don't know where they were in their careers when they came, if they were at the start or if they were, well-known at the time. But, man, what a great group.
So cool. And I know that, you know, Classy Ballou, whose family goes on performing in this community, sadly, he passed away last year. But he moved because of that venue.
And, he became the leader of the house band, right?
1963, he joined the house band and stayed there and performed at
Incredible.
Walker's till it closed in the 70s. Just to kind of situate where Walker Auditorium is, it's actually out a little bit, out Clifton Street. So if you can go out to kind of the corner of Clifton and Faulkner, and in the V there, you'll actually still see cinder blocks where the walls of Walker Auditorium was at one point.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Now, you talked about the importance of the African-American community, but it didn't just draw folks from the African-American community, because out in that side of town at the time, we had Connolly Air Force Base, mm-hmm. of course, the students at the different colleges that were here. I mean, I think it was attended by a large swath of Waco.
Particularly in the 60s and 70s, early 70s, it becomes much more of a kind of interracial space. A lot of Baylor students are going over to Walker Auditorium. I mean, if you wanted to hear good live music, Waco Auditorium.
Yeah, I'm going to say, if you're going to hear B.B. King, then, you know, there's nothing going to stop you from going to the space. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I love that the arts and the power of music was part of that desegregation story for Waco.
I think this is really a continuation, the next place I'm going to discuss, continuation of the Cotton Palace discussion. We didn't really talk about why the Cotton Palace failed, but its last year was 1930, and so that was unfortunately a pretty bad year in America. That was the stock market collapse, beginning of the Great Depression. Cotton took a huge hit in that, and was really part of the really decline of cotton as a major part of our economy here, because as we've discussed before, we realized we really needed to diversify as a city. The city leaders did, and so thankfully we've done a good job of that. But that made the Cotton Palace dormant for several years. But in the post-war era, there was a desire really to kind of revive the aura of the Cotton Palace, and that was done through what we now know as Heart of Texas Coliseum.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. So the vision, or, you know, they were really looking at, hey, that the expositions, you used it before when we started discussing Cotton Palace as a way for people to understand what the Cotton Palace was. Ironically, it became patterned after the Cotton Palace. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, very interesting.
But the idea of...
So the Extraco Center is, is the inheritor of that vision.
Yeah. So it was built in 1953, I believe, is when it was opened. And here's a fun little trivia fact. They had a nationwide naming contest for the Heart of Texas, for the building. And so there was a lady in McGregor, Texas, Mrs. John Cousins, who won the $100 for coming up with the name Heart O Texas Coliseum.
Hmm.
And bravo, her.
And that's O with an apostrophe.
No F, yeah.
Heart O Texas. Mm-hmm. So.
Wow. I wonder what she did with that $100. Hopefully she got to see a good
show. She's probably spending on a corn dog and some, one ride.
I wonder what the ticket prices were at some of these price points. You know, I was looking at the souvenir program for the auditorium, and ticket prices there were from 1 cent to $4. You couldn't get much arts and entertainment these days for that.
For that much. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm sure $100 was a lot of money in those days. That was, it was definitely worth her submitting her suggestion.
And just to connect the fairgrounds to an earlier podcast, our military podcast, that space, that whole area was part of the original Rich Field.
Mm-hmm.
So that was, as the city built out, that land remained a municipal airport until the 40s. So as you can imagine, as the city built out, there was this nice big block of land that was starting to get a city around it. And that's, you know, started getting used for, you know, Waco High. Eventually Waco High was built there on the property, and some of the other parks and amenities, but also that was a great place to put the fair.
One club that I want to mention, just because as I was thinking about Waco Auditorium, is the Abraxas Club. I want to make sure and mention that as well, which was kind of the Tejano Club in the 1970s. In Waco, Stevie Ray Vaughan, named after the Carlos Santana album. The Abraxas Club was a really important kind of gathering place for the Chicano movement in the 1970s, and another great live music kind of spot that became really an important kind of social and cultural gathering place in the 70s.
So there's some places that are not buildings, but public spaces, I think are worth mentioning. Probably a lot of people or some of our listeners have gone to concerts at Indian Springs Park. There's a beautiful amphitheater. It's hard to see when you're driving by at street level, but you know, if you get off in the park, it's a beautiful amphitheater that goes down,
And backed by the river. I mean, it's just, isn't that stunning? Yeah, it makes such a lovely semi-natural amphitheater, and I've seen everything from the symphony to Shakespeare plays there. It makes a really nice venue for all kinds of things.
Yes. On a beautiful summer night, sitting on the grass. It's great.
And of course, that's home to, there are many festivals now that flank the banks of the river. And I think festivals are one of the great activators for a place like Waco that has, for at least a chunk of the year, a good enough, you know, good climate for being outdoors and enjoying the outdoors.
You know, the MCC has a great...
Musky River stage.
Yeah, as well.
Love that space.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That was probably built in the early 2000s. Anybody? I don't have that.
I don't remember.
But part of their... you mentioned their music school and their commercial music school. I mean, what a great asset to have in our community.
And then the Ball for Performing Arts Center as well, you know, adding to the portfolio of performance spaces in our community.
Okay, here's a little hidden gem that I just love. You really gotta go look for this, but if you're going down University Parks and about at the intersection with Colcord, which is pretty close to, it's right behind the City of Waco's facility that used to be the old pumping facility for water out of the Brazos. Mm-hmm. Anyway, if you look off towards the pump house away from the river, there's a little ribbon of concrete with some steps that goes up to a rough-hewn stone obelisk that's about, you know, 10 feet tall. And you go up and look at it, there's a little sculpture of Shakespeare on it, and there's a couple of plaques on it, and one of them says, "Immortal be his name, Waco Shakespeare Club." And it has two dates on it, 1899 and 1916. And I'm assuming 1916 is when they put the monument up, and 1899 is when the club started, which coincides with the Waco Auditorium, ironically.
Yes, that was, yeah.
But obviously there was a public space created here to perform Shakespeare.
And Shakespeare in the Park, no less.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. And, you know, Rick, I'm going to point out that these outdoor spaces, natural air conditioning, right? Makes it maybe a little more, you know,
a little less controlled,
a broader bandwidth of usability.
Yeah.
Wonderful. I mean, Shakespeare in the Park is definitely something that Waco lends itself to. I'm saying this out there in case someone is listening. I know that Wild Imaginings have piloted a couple of Shakespeare's in the Park. And yeah, I think that's a great opportunity.
Well, and while we're kind of on the subject of talking about University Parks in that area, there's a bunch of art going down that road now. And I know
you may
know a little bit about that. Why don't you share?
Well, yes. I mean, you immediately see two different kinds of art going along that section that you just mentioned. One is the animal sculptures, which were installed back in 2020. Ironically, you know, just the event that we had to dedicate the sculptures and thank the donors who contributed to those. Was, I think, a week before the lockdown for the pandemic. But what that meant was that immediately, as soon as they were installed, they became one of the safest things for families to do together. So right from the point where people were able to be out and about walking in socially distanced groups, people were just loving those sculptures. Mm-hmm. So that's thanks to Clifton and Betsy Robinson, who've been amazing benefactors for so many things in our community, but including public art. And they had that vision of having animal sculptures along the river. And long story short, they invited a number of other people to weigh in on that. And so we ended up with something which originally was a vision to have 6 sculptures turned into 27 sculptures, thanks to the generosity of people in our community. But the other sculptures, which I know people will have really noticed around the suspension bridge area, are the steers branding the Brazos. And that's again, Clifton and Betsy as the lead donors, with a number of people from across our community working with Doreen Ravenscroft and Cultural Arts of Waco. And that is, of course, commemorating Waco's role as the strategic crossing of the river with the suspension bridge and its role as part of the Chisholm Trail.
Right. The crossroads of Waco.
There we go.
So, pause for effect.
Yes. Well, that Well, keep going from there. You know, give us some vision for future places and spaces that, I mean, you've mentioned a little bit, but stuff that you guys have vision for as Waco continues to move forward.
Well, and of course, right on the other side of the river was the next vision that Cultural Arts of Waco had, which was the Doris Miller Memorial. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was a wonderful testament to the military history and, of course, the African-American history of mm-hmm. Waco. Because we have so many amazing locations, so much potential, last year we actually got a grant from National Endowment for the Arts to conduct a public art strategic planning process. So that means that now as we look forward, we have a really good pathway to make sure that we are doing a great job of telling some of the stories about our community when we think about public art opportunities. We're seeing such a lot of growth and flourishing, lots of new developers wanting to come in and do stuff. And often they want to know, well, what can we do that's going to be historically significant for this community? So we now have a pathway of being able to make sure that when people are interested in doing public art, there's a pathway to making sure that we're doing a great job of commemorating some of these historical gems. And then we, as an organization, are working with City of Waco at feasibility for a new performing arts center. So there's actually a feasibility study that's been conducted, and we're now working towards conceptual renderings for that. But that will be right on the river, so on University Parks and Franklin. So that pivot point right at the crossroads.
Mm-hmm.
Well, speaking of statues, I just got to throw this in there because I walked past today as I came here by Waco's two newest statues, which are of Robert Gilbert and Barbara Walker, which a crane was putting them on their pedestal as I was walking over here, and those will be unveiled soon. But again, as we try to think about our representations of what we commemorate and how we commemorate it and who's in a part of that story, we need to be inclusive and strategic.
Well, and that's a great way of saying arts are powerful. The mm-hmm. symbols that we have in our community are really powerful. And the spaces that we create and the opportunities that we create are also powerful and emblematic. We can see through that history, looking back, the kinds of spaces that we created have characterized the reputation of our community to the outside world. Mm-hmm. So it's really important how we do this.
Okay. Well, I think that that gets us pretty tied up on places and spaces, and we may
want to mention, should we mention Magnolia? I mean, it seems like an ending point with Palace. If we talk about the Cotton Palace
has this
extreme draw, and just the draw of that space as an entertainment venue.
Well, and especially when we think of Magnolia in the context of the spaces that we create mm-hmm. are what earns our reputation in the outside world. And one of the things that I really love about what that vision has done for Waco is, you know, I say to people, and I'm sure you've heard this before, but I don't think people are making that pilgrimage. And it really is a pilgrimage that many folks who come to mm-hmm. Magnolia are making, a pilgrimage of a kind. They're not coming for the expensive candles. They're coming because there is a vision cast in what Chip and Joanna have done with the TV show and with the spaces that they have created, which I think is threefold. It's really interesting. One is that they have done a great job of creating places where people can gather in real time and space and prioritize family time or friend time. So it's about creating invitational spaces. That's what the show does. You know, every single fixer-upper is about creating a place where people can gather. And I think they've done that for Waco. The second is, I think there's a real vision there about how to prioritize the balance between work and family, faith, you know, all the things that we consider to be important in life. So creating spaces where we can find good balance. And the third is the metaphor of fixing up. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in some ways, as we look back at Waco's history, Waco itself is the fixer-upper, but then so are each of us. There is no one who is not themselves broken in some way. And so that metaphor and that visual representation of taking things that have outlive their use, repurposing them, finding new use and fresh meaning, I think is incredibly powerful for Waco's future.
That might be the deepest thing that's ever been said on this podcast.
It is. It went way deep. Yeah.
That is awesome.
Sorry, guys. I'll come back to the surface.
And air conditioning. So I want to ask, just because I know you've thought about this, just the reintroduction or the prospects of the reintroduction of a grand sort of event space with the Foster Pavilion coming in. Just what sort of prospects does that present as a city space? You know, we can talk about it as a Baylor space, but you've thought about it from the city end. If you could talk a little bit about that.
Yes, and any space of that kind. You know, obviously there are days when it's not going to be used for tournaments and... It does lend itself, especially to things like rock concerts, like mid-sized concerts, that kind of thing. I will say that something that is purpose-built for sports is rarely the very best fit for things that require very high sound definition. So when we're talking rock concerts, perfect. That's amplification. It's engineered sound. Totally fine for that. So hopefully it will mean that we can bring in some, you know, some good 8,000 seater type events to Waco. That would be its sweet spot. And obviously there's a potential capture of market for, you know, people that are going from Dallas, Fort Worth down to Austin or vice versa. You know, there's the whole kind of South by plus circuit, Austin city limits, that kind of thing. So there's an opportunity to capture things that we can't yet do as a community. But there is a very unique, there is another need over and above that. You know, I've had people say to me, isn't that enough? Isn't that, you know, everything that we need? But the truth is that, you know, now we're so sophisticated at the way that we listen to and experience. We want, as a generation now, we expect to have fully immersive experiences in a way that I think has been amplified by, no pun intended, our experience during the pandemic of being able to live stream anything we wanted or, you know, experience anything that we wanted in the comfort of our own home. But there's also a craving for in-person real experiences. So the idea of having a 2,000-seater auditorium just up from that pavilion space, I think allows us to create, you know, a portfolio of spaces that can be used not just in their own right, but also in conversation with each other. So, of course, we have the McLean Stadium as well. The idea of having things which converse between different venues in our community and with the convention center that allow us to bring much bigger, more visionary festivals, multi-venue experiences to Waco, I think is incredibly exciting. And then they all activate the river. I have a, well, not so secret dream because I'm about to say it, but I definitely
we heard it here. We got the scoop on the Waco History Podcast. That's awesome.
Here it goes. Yeah, not so much history, but vision for the future. The idea of sailgating for the arts or sailgating for entertainment where we can do live streaming, where, you know, for example, you're out on your boat on the Brazos, you have a family, which you might not want to do the kind of quiet thing with young kids in an auditorium space. But what you might want to do is, for example, you know, your kids are mad about ballet or mad about music. You can live stream within a geofenced area the performance that's going on, and then your ticket for doing that also allows you to moor up and go to the after party and meet the cast. So there are all kinds of things that I can that we can do that I think are value adds to the live experience that allow us to broaden the audience, broaden the experience, make it more adaptable for, I think, a diverse public that wants to experience live things in a multiplicity of ways, just like we do with sports.
As a guy with a kayak, I love that vision.
I have a kayak too. Well, no, I'll be there with you.
Well, and are you mad about kayaks? Because I think she's using some terminology that doesn't, you know, we don't. When my kids are mad about something, it's not that they want to do it. So they're usually mad at me.
No, I used a Britishism.
I knew what she meant.
So, right. Yes, no, I say
don't
mad
be
about
so
in
provincial.
The sense of,
well, so,
of
so
being
ironically,
very fond of. Yeah.
The vision you're throwing out there, a few years back, Fiona and I were both starting two organizations or part of groups that were starting two organizations at the time. the Greater Waco Sports Commission, and then what eventually became
Creative Waco.
Waco.
Yeah.
And a lot of discussions at the time, remember, we'd get people in the room and they would talk about, we'd be talking about bringing more events and doing more stuff. Well, you can't do that because that's always my weekend. Or no, you're going to have to find another. The whole idea was very linear. Mm-hmm. You know, like, oh, we can only do one thing in Waco at a time.
Yeah. I remember being told that. I remember people telling me when we arrived here that, you know, if we have more than one performance on the same night, that's it. There won't be an audience for both.
Yeah.
And, you know, just three weekends ago, we actually had four theater performances on the same weekend. We now have 7 theater companies in Waco, wow, which is extraordinary. 4 performances one weekend, and every single one of them was sold out.
Wow, fantastic. Yeah.
And that mindset has changed because people are thinking, mm-hmm, about how to layer these events together, how to have more of a festival mindset.
Yeah. Clustering,
it's
an economic reality for Waco now.
Right. Yeah. If we're going to have a vibrant downtown, there's got to be a lot of different things going on. And that's, I think, the beauty of the Foster Pavilion being downtown, mm-hmm, is going to provide a big chunk of that connectivity.
Well, I'm thinking of Waco as a destination and as a, in a joined up way. One of the things I love about the fact that the Sports Commission and Creative Waco were started at the same time is that it really allowed some of that joined up thinking, mm-hmm, because there are, I don't know anybody that only likes doing one thing.
Right.
Most people and most families have a multiplicity of interests. And so we want to create an exciting, livable place that has all those things. And then that takes us right back to the Cotton Palace again,
yeah,
and to all these venues and spaces we've just been talking about, because they really did offer that. Waco has always been a place that has offered a multitude of different kinds of arts and cultural experiences, probably right from the powwows.
Well, we're going to end where we began.
That's right.
Rick,
sounds
you invited the right person.
Man.
Thank you for inviting Fiona.
Thank you so much. This has been so much fun. I've learned a ton.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to the Waco History Podcast. Like what you heard? Subscribe, rate, and review our show on iTunes so we can reach more listeners. You can find show notes and info on every episode at wacohistorypodcast.com. And more info on Waco's past at wacohistory.org. Our theme music, used with permission, is Cross the Brazos at Waco, performed by the late Billy Walker. For more info on Billy's music, go to billywalker.com. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time. This has been a Rogue Media Network production.